Good evening. This meeting of the Winthrop Town Council for July 7th, 2015 is now called to order. This meeting is being recorded and may be televised live. Council Clerk Denise, would you call the roll, please?
Council Callow, present. Council Sanford, Council Boncory.
Here.
Council Barone.
Here.
Council Terry.
Here.
Council Biagin.
Here.
Council Davento.
Yep.
Vice President Mayo.
Here.
President Gill.
Yes.
Thank you.
Quorum is present. Move on to the meeting. Could I have a motion for the minutes of June 16th, 2015 as circulated?
Motion.
Motion by Council Terry, seconded by?
Second.
Council Biagin, any discussion on the minutes? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Winthrop Airport Hazards Committee has requested to have their, regarding a review and posting a review of the comments on the LAHHS Logan Airport Health Study. I welcome the committee members that are here, Mr. Bangs, Mr. Driscoll.
I'm on this side of the camera for change, okay?
Yeah, stay there.
Might get my good side, would you? If I may.
Mr. Mahajan and Ms. Fix.
Okay. As you know, Tony Mahajan is over, he's our chairman of the committee, but he's our scientific guru. So I'd like to kick this off, and although you folks are aware that we've had this study done, I think you ought to know a little bit about the background, so we go into the work, where we're coming from and where we've been. And of course, the interest tonight is to get the results of the latest study that came out of this health study published and out to the public, because they have a right to know. However, there was a legislative act in 2000, and within the Department of Public Health, and specifically the Bureau of Environmental Health, to undertake a, I'd like to get these words very carefully, undertake a risk assessment of the health impact by Logan Airport on communities within a 5-mile radius of the airport. Now that involves 17 communities during that period. And initially there was only a few bucks available, and it was a pilot study initiated. And then there was some more money continued from time to time as it came available through the legislature. But anyway, conclusions are there was an impact sources. What they're saying is near surface, it's the surface of measurements are what really bothered them in this study. And the air pollutants were low by and large relative, this is the study now, relative to measured concentrations. And this, although there was some elevation in respiratory health in the high exposure areas, especially in children, and also some COPD in adults noted, for those people who lived 3 years or more in a specific area during the survey. Great, and very interesting. However, there were no significant differences in cardiovascular outcomes in the population during across the high, medium, and low exposure. And very little statistical difference on hearing loss in correlation to those living in the high exposure versus low exposure area. These are all factors that they put in this report. But anyway, they want to get this going, and they recommend in the report that Massport and, and all of their other agents should review studies to determine mitigation, and mitigation of their requirements. Was they reduced it into writing, reduce the air pollution within its control, whatever they could do to mitigate that, including using alternative fuel vehicles on the airport proper, okay? And then work with East Boston Neighborhood Health Center regarding local air pollutants versus urban areas as opposed to the local area. Okay, this happened during the period of 2000 to 2005. Okay, in 2005, the results of the study were always all gathered together, and then from 2005, for 2 or 3 years, they went out for a peer review. Now, you may laugh at this, but peer review, they had some heavy hitters, various universities looking, but it took several years for the peer review to be done. And then in May of 2004, we get this magnificent document out, which has a lot of data in it, and that's what we finally had. Meanwhile, we had a couple of meetings, one back about, oh, I think around 2012, down at the senior center, and there were a lot of people over at Logan in some, the Court Park section of Winthrop saying, where's the data? Where's the results? These are young folks with young families. We don't have it. Well, finally, we have it here, because they were very adamant to try to find out what is the status here. But in May of 2014, 14 years after they initially authorized these people at the Department of Public Health to go ahead and get something else. We finally got data in here, and some of the statistics, as I pointed out, when you take 17 communities, there are those that are out of reaches of this. Then you take the Winthrop, East Boston, Chelsea, Revere, if you divide whatever the results are by 17 communities, sure, we wind up in the norm, don't we? Because they dilute the whole study. In fact, they also were talking about the insignificant number of people surveyed. So anyway, that's where we are today. And Tony wants to comment in a couple of minutes about the contents of the study and what we'd like to have done. As you know, we had $4,000. The airport hazards, I'm using a very colloquial term that we all know, but it's a long phrase of our official name. But we never had a lot of money. We always had a few bucks from the town meeting appropriated, and from time to time we carry forward and get a replenishment. But we spent the money that we had with an outside consultant, a PhD in New York University, very familiar with these kinds of analyses and all, and we had $4,000. Well, what can you get for $4,000? Really a scratch of the surface. So we're not here tonight trying to look for money specifically from you folks. We want to get the okay, because finally, after 14 years, they came out with this book, and Tony is going to address in a few minutes. We don't know what the value is, because the data was taken only goes through 2009. It's already 5 years beyond the pale right now. So, you know, how valid is it today? Tony wants to go ahead on that. So, again, we want, Tony, why don't you come up and sit over here and give your aspect of it, or what your approach was, just so these folks will know, and then I'll come back with the second part of the things that I wanted to say before the committee, okay?
All right. Thanks, Dick.
Thank you, Dick.
Well, thank you for the time.
Thank you.
And I think the issue here is we want to release this to the town website, this report, and the evaluation of the report basically is saying that there's a number of statistically flaws in the design of the report. So when that means that the reliability of the report is not there. It's no fault of anybody taking the sample data. It's just the way it was initially designed. And so when I had this evaluated by Dr. Thurston, the main things he came up with were, and I'm not going to bore you with the craziness of the statistics. I hated statistics. So. Basically, the main things are, and if you've read, everybody should have read this report. It was underpowered due to a too small of a sample size for conducting the proposed test as to whether the adverse effects from air pollution or not affected people. Now, when it's underpowered, it means that the sample size was too small. And I have a little quick blurb here. And when the sample size is too small, I guess basically it's saying you're not getting a reliable study. You're looking at something and it's like a false positive, or it could even be a false negative. So you really don't know where you are. So we go in and we get the study done, and now you don't know whether or not there is a health effect. It can go both ways. And so, and then there was another thing about the odds ratio that I had a hard time grasping in the report, which basically said that it's the ratio of, I hate reciting this, but it's the ratio of the odds of an event occurring in one group to the odds of it occurring in another group, or data-based, to a database of that ratio. So odds ratio estimates the probability of the disease given exposure to people to a specific event by measuring the probability of exposure given to the presence of the disease. So basically it's trying to say, if there's no disease, no one should get sick. But sometimes there's going to be people getting sick that's not really related to that. But so those are the main things. And then the other thing was that George Thurston said, it should be, the data should be reanalyzed because this idea that I think we've touched upon before, we have three different groups. We have low, medium, and high. And Dr. Thurston is saying that that's not the way to do it. You should take, rather than grouping it like that, because some places in the low group, there's high pollution. So they did a mean. So if you look at this on a continuous basis, wherever the person lived, then you use that data rather than grouping it into low, medium, and high exposures. I'm not sure if I'm really making myself clear, but it's, okay, so then he came up with this, and then Suzanne Condon, the author of the report, came up with a rebuttal. And she basically, you should have seen that, that was the letter of December 26th. And she sort of was saying, you know, no, you're all wrong, Dr. Thurston, and this is the reason why. But Dr. Thurston came back saying, no, you're missing the point. And they thought, by the way, back with that continuous analysis of the air pollution in each low, medium, high, they did try that, but then they threw it out for some reason. I don't know why, and then Dr. Thurston came back with his first rebuttal to their first rebuttal. And again, it's the back, bumping ahead over the odds ratio and the number of people that were included in the study. So then Dr. Condon, she came back with the last one on June 12th and came back with harder decisions. And one of the lines is, well, there were more than 6,000 adults, there were significantly fewer children, which doesn't tell you much what's going for the children. If you read through this, he states that it's, she's concerned when he states it is made clear from the results printed in the report themselves that there are inadequate power to test an odds ratio of 1.2. In other words, this odds ratio, again, has something to do with the probability of getting sick. And if there was not enough people to do it, it doesn't mean anything. It's giving you I could give you, again, false positive or false negative of what's going on from the air pollution. So at this point, we have Dr. Thurston's two points, and then we have two from the state, Mass Department. So now, it's basically, we just could go on ad infinitum. And we just want to get all this information out to the people, so let them make their own decisions. Maybe we'll get lucky and there's a PhD statistician in town and says, oh, this looks like a front project to do. Let me look through it. But they won't have all the data. So we would really like to get this allowed to be published on the website. And let's go back a few minutes. It's taken, one more second. It's taken $2 million to do this report by the state. It's taken 4 years to pull this report together. And now we find out it's not really reliable. So we're back at stage one for this legislation that Dick was talking about, where we're supposed to determine if there's any effects. In my opinion, there's no real proof that there is an effect. So therefore, we're back to stage one. And again, it could be less effects, or it could be more effects, but we're at a point where it doesn't look like that. It doesn't look very good to put our reliability on it. Also, one of the last things, he talked about doing BenMap, which is an EPA model. And the model can go through and predict how many people are going to die and everything based on not the data collected by Massport or in the area, but on national numbers. So when they looked at the national numbers and they stick it in their formulas and into their model, they'll come on how many people are going to die, how many people are going to go to hospital, how many people are going to have a cardiac arrest or whatever. We want to use that. That could cost some money for someone to do it. Well, you could hire a consultant to do it. I'm thinking of trying to do it because it's going to be done on a regular computer. And that was the other thing. Now, let's see. And we want to go on to WCAT to talk about this evaluation report. And basically, what I'm saying is that there's no reason to be alarmed or anything. It's just that when you want to evaluate something, you want to get the best evaluation. You want to make sure that nothing's out of you know, the ducks aren't off kilter. So, one more thing. Oh, this is what I want to say. If sample size is too low, the experiment will lack precision to provide reliable answers to the questions it is investigating. If the sample size is too large, this is where you have to calculate, time and resources would be wasted, often for minimal gain. So we're at the other end of that spectrum. We want to see more samples. And George's paper said that he would like to see 13,000 people sent. So now you can't go back to do that because that's 10 years ago. So you can't, you can use the new models too. They'll have new air pollution models at the airport and they'll predict what's going to be hit in the low, medium, and high areas. But you still have to survey the people to get a full understanding of what's happening to their health. I think that's about all I want to say.
I want to put a couple of things on here.
I'll get up for you. So thank you for your time.
A couple more minutes, Mr. President.
This is my backup.
Okay, now we're not mad at anybody. But we said that we'd like to get the okay from you folks to release the study. Tony tells me it's about 12 pages, I think, 14, the sum. That we want to get on the town website. We'd also like to go on TV and come up with the detailed information. You don't want to listen to details tonight. You don't have the time or the inclination, okay? But in the meantime, we had a couple of things go through our mind. As I said earlier, when on my initial part of my presentation, it takes money to do some of these things. We don't have a heck of a big budget. The town's running very tight. You've got the gentleman behind going to report financially later, but we're okay, but regardless. The thing is, we have to think about funds. It went through my mind specifically. You know, we're not angry with Logan. We're not angry with the Department of Public Health. We think we have to have more work done. But you know, back, oh, I think it was this last winter, Logan came down here, officials from them, and they presented information to us about the $350,000 that they had broken loose to make some more studies for the East Boston Neighborhood Health Center on Logan employees and also up in East Boston. And by the way, the health center has done a heck of a job with a lot of people using it up there, and it's quite an effective facility. And they said half of that's going to go to Winthrop. And they talked about that day of opening up a facility down here and maybe a clinic so that we can be addressed some of the problems on the local level. Started to think, you know, Winthrop Hospital, unfortunately, was sold a number of years ago.
Just not to interrupt, Mr. Bank, but the topic tonight is the report that came out.
Okay.
And the posting on the website.
But I want to ask
We'll bring that up.
Well, all right, if that's what you want to send.
Yeah.
All right.
I'd rather.
So we'd like to get another subject, perhaps for another night,
yep.
Some funding on this, and talk to you. But we would like your approval so that we can go on the air, give the statistical data, and then be able to, in the future, continue on, just to satisfy everybody. We're doing the best thing we can to try to preserve the health of the town of Winthrop.
Right.
So because it's doing great, the town. We certainly don't want to hurt the town.
No, we don't. Yes.
Mr. President, I forgot one key thing. You're all familiar with Air Incorporated out of East Boston.
Yep.
It's sort of a private, I guess, 501c, and that's looking into the problems of the health, same we are as we have done in Winthrop. And I spoke to a woman down at Environmental Health and Engineering. It's a firm that the Air Incorporated people have hired, and she's friendly with George Thurston. And they looked at each other's thing, and they said, yeah, we're both on the same line. So that means that the study that Air Incorporated just received last month, which I haven't had a chance to read yet, says that the study was inadequate to get the type of information that we wanted and possibly that met the requirements of the legislation.
Okay. On the issue of the reports, is there any question from the council?
Yes, sir.
Bill?
Council. I'm seeking to have the letters that went from Thurston to the chairman and from Condon to the chairman as well posted on the website.
That's what we're going to publish.
All four letters
all
and the report?
Yeah.
Every side is going to be represented.
Hold on.
Sorry.
The motion is the four letters. If someone would like to add to the four letters, I also have with me tonight the report that they gave at the public hearing, and they called it the summary. We can post that.
Yeah.
And they had a Q&A that we could publish along with it. We don't want to publish that report that Bob Driscoll was holding in his hand, that 1,000-page report. So, are there any other questions from the council? If not, while the committee is still here, I'd like to move on to new business, have a motion on this proposal, and then a vote. If there is no objection, I'll move on to new business. We did have a motion in front of us that said, that they move that the town council direct the town manager to post the review of the Logan Airport Health Study, that was George Thurston's report dated November 26th, and his follow-up report dated December 26th, along with the responses by Suzanne Condon from the DPH/BEH, dated December 26th and June 12th. Post those on the town website. Do those if you would like. We'll make an amendment that we add the executive summary of the Logan Airport Health Study that was presented on May 2014 and the question and answer that was presented on that same day. So the motion is that we'll produce those and publish those six documents. Mm-hmm. But I have a motion from Councilor Lettieri, seconded by Councilor Boncorry. Discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for your ongoing commitment to Logan Airport.
We'll be back at your invitation.
Yep, okay.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on, the next item on the agenda is the public hearing. In the public hearing, I will read the newspaper notice. Notice is hereby given in accordance with Chapter 48 of the Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 17 of the Code of Town Winthrop, that the Winthrop Town Council will conduct a public hearing on Tuesday, July 7th, 2015, on or after 7 p.m. in the Harvey Hearing Room, that the Town Council authorize the transfer of $132,800 from the Capital Stabilization Fund for engineering services relative to the redevelopment of middle fields and drainage improvements at Lewis Lake, or take any other action relative thereto. At this point, I'll open the public hearing. Is there any question or comment from the public about this proposal? If not, is there any question or comment from the council about this proposal?
Can you just explain that again, what we were just saying?
This is the engineering to present, that the hearing is to determine the public's feeling and our feeling on appropriation of $132,800 to start the engineering for that project.
It has been mapped out. There are blue flags down there. There was a machine down there this morning. They drilled in 8 or 9 different places, taking soil samples to go forward with this project.
Great. Okay, good.
I think the public's
Okay, is there any further comment on the public hearing? If not, we have two options. We can close the public hearing or we can continue it until the next meeting. Could I have a motion from the council to close the public hearing? Motion to close by Councilor Lettieri, seconded by Councilor Sanford. All those in favor of closing the public hearing say aye.
Aye.
Public hearing is closed. Okay, moving on to public comment. Yes, Ms. Manning.
Don Manning, Precinct 3. I want to again thank Councilor Mayo for being the only one to return a comment on the email that I had sent about the very large, oversized truck that was stuck in front of my house on Memorial Day weekend on that Sunday night at 8:30. My husband and I did come to a town council meeting, and I did ask the councilors, when I did send it off to all of you, if you were able to view it, and I understand a lot of you said that you could not. My husband did show a bunch of you afterwards how to play it on the iPads, and those of you that said that you could not view it, I would have expected an email in return that said to me that you could not view it, and I then would have forwarded again. So I do want to thank Councilor Mayo for being the one to respond to me. In response to that, the trucks are very large. The chief said we do not have a weight limit to the trucks in Winthrop. The truck that was stuck in front of my house that night, that I did nicely go out of my way to move my car so the gentleman could move because the traffic was backed up, including the Paul Revere truck on a Sunday holiday night at 8:30 at night, was 48 feet, I believe that gentleman told me. And he offered to show me his paperwork, which is on the video as well. It's on YouTube as well. You can go on and view it under my name, Dawn Manning, MWRA. It's on my YouTube channel. There's lots of videos from the things I've caught that MWRA. It's disturbing. The trucks are huge. They're oversized. They come very early in the morning. My husband is a 100% combat disabled veteran. The trucks are up on my neighbor's sidewalk. They come down like a large bang. They shake my house. They startle my husband. He has PTSD. Do you know what his day starts like? Every single day. Do you think that's fair to him? We've asked. So I'm again asking the council to please consider putting on the agenda an item that discusses the weight limit to the trucks coming in this town. I have not yet seen a sign at the new bridge that declares exactly what the weight limit is, even though the fire chief has said what the weight limit is. What is that weight limit, fire chief?
I can't give you, maybe Steve Cal.
No discussion, public comment is for comment.
So, you know, I think it's about time that these 52-foot trucks, oversized trucks, and on the video, the gentleman driving the truck who offered me all kinds of information about the load, which were these huge, long, special pipes going to 180 or 190 Taft Ave, which is that big empty lot, Winthrop. 190 Taft Ave, 180, 190 Taft Ave, that is the big empty lot at Deer Island. It wasn't even going to the MWRA, so it's a fake address on its paperwork as well. So, you know, they're stuck, they're oversized. We're on a shifting sandbar, we live down the point. I did see in the MWRA board meeting that I looked up that we received a year extension on our package. I don't know exactly what that means. We got an extension for a year for $760,000. So what do we get another year to gamble what we're gonna get from them? I think we deserve more than that. I think the point is getting hammered. I don't even know what else to say, and I can't give you any more pictures of the 52-foot trucks that are going down my street, or what my quality of life is like, what my husband's quality of life is like, what my neighbor's quality of life is like. I think it's time that you address this once and for all. You've been given another year to do something. I don't know. I don't get any of this information. I don't. The only person that's even responded to me is Mr. Mayo, and he's not even my counselor. I can't even get in touch with my counselor. So I would please ask you to consider putting on the agenda a weight limit, or discussing it, the size limit of these trucks. They don't even need to be this big to bring in half the stuff coming to Deer Island. And we don't even know who these people are coming into our town, unaccounted for. They could be strangers dumping trash bags into our waters and halfway across the country for a trash bag of God knows what is found. Could be anything in that trash bag. And they're back in Boondock City before it's washed up for one of our residents to find. Evidence is gone. What else is gone?
Thank you, Mrs. Manning. Moving on to correspondence. We had a correspondence that there was a legislative luncheon run by Speaker DeLeo and Senator Petrocelli coming up at the Elks. And the date of that is, I believe, the
21st.
Chamber sponsors it, that's right. And I'll come up with the date later on in the meeting.
It's
July 20th.
July 20th, okay, thank you.
12 o'clock.
And the tickets are $25.
$25 per person.
Thank you, Russ. That's all the correspondence. Under committee reports, the Finance Committee meeting.
Finance Committee met prior to this meeting on the $132,800 transfer for the Lewis Lake Drainage Project for engineering. Has moved forward with a positive recommendation, although I think those motions are going to be postponed until next week.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the end of it.
Although I think those motions will be postponed until next week.
Okay. Moving on to the Town Manager's Report. I'm sorry, Ordinance Review Committee.
Thank you, Mr. President. On June 23rd and on June 30th, the Ordinance Review Committee met and discussed the following topics. Recall or abandonment of an elected position. Methodology for which councilors can vote to increase their pay, and which a motion was made to pass, to allow a pay raise after two election cycles if the motion was made by June preceding an election. Just to clarify that, as it currently stands right now, it would take only five members of the council would be eligible to vote due to ethics rulings. So with this regard, all nine members of the council could vote if it followed two election cycles. We also discussed publication requirements that we employ. Currently, we have to advertise in a newspaper. And at least on one occasion, the Lynn item was used to make a deadline. We were talking about possibly allowing electronic methods. Motion was made that any councilor could pass could place an agenda item up for consideration. The motion failed. It should be and the thought was it should be addressed in council rules. We also discussed council president's duties, town manager duties. The town manager asked for consideration on who should declare a state of emergency, and it was determined that that should be done by ordinance and not by charter. Our report is due to the council on the 16th of this month, and on charter revisions only, and the council should vote on that by the 21st of this month so that it could make the ballot in November.
Thank you, Councilor. Town Manager's Report?
Nothing really to report on the finance side. We're closing the books. No end of year transfers tonight. We still have next week's meeting where we can still do transfers. Don't foresee any, but see how next week proceeds.
Thank you. Mr. McKenna is out of town. That's why Tim is filling in. Under the school department, update, the Winthrop High School has a new assistant principal. Michael Capasso was appointed assistant principal of the high school. School closing at the end of the year went very well, very smoothly, according to all the reports that we have. There was a mistake in the transcript last week about the opening, so as one pointed out to me, that it was reported that the opening of the school was going to be in 2017, but can you just fill us in?
The editorial in the transcript on July 2nd was primarily about the Miller Field issue, but it referenced the new school project being completed in August 2017, and it's basically the school year in 2016, the opening of the school year.
So about a year from now,
yeah.
As opposed to
2 years
from now.
We don't want people to think that we were behind, because we're not.
Right, it's progressing on schedule and
on
budget.
On schedule and on target.
Great, thank you. So just a correction on that date.
Thank you.
There's no further school department update. On the old business, we had the motion to move that the town council authorize the transfer $132,800 from the capital stabilization fund for engineering services relative to the redevelopment of Miller Field and the drainage improvements at Lewis Lake. I'll take any other action relative thereto. Motion by Councilor Delvento.
Well, that actually came out of finance committee, but I think we're going to postpone that vote until after next week's presentation.
Okay. So you did come out with a positive report.
Yes.
So we'll make a motion to postpone to the next meeting.
Yes.
Okay. And the reason that it makes sense to postpone to the next meeting is next Tuesday, We're having a special meeting where the special council meeting, there'll be a presentation on this whole package, so it makes sense to postpone it till then. So the motion has been postponed to the next meeting. Is there any other old business? If not, we'll move on to new business. And we have appointments with us tonight. We have the chairman of the Board of Health, Nick LaConte, and Nick's somehow reappointment got overlooked. I'll take the hit. So I would like to make a motion to reappoint Nick LaConte, chairman of the Board of Health, for another 3-year term to 6/30/2008.
Make a motion to approve the appointment.
Motion to affirm the appointment by Councilor Boncorry, second by Councilor Lettieri. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. On the school bills, thank you, Nick, for your continued service, and you're doing a great job. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much, everyone.
The School Building Assistance Committee has traditionally been appointed for 1-year appointments, and I'm going to do that again this time. I had talked to you about maybe doing just for the rest of the term, but I'm going to do it for 1 year to keep the ball rolling. So on the School Building Assistance Committee, which is the committee that's responsible for the building of the new high school, I'd like to reappoint James McKenna, town manager, James Lettieri, representative of the town council, Tim Gordon, CFO, Dave Dockendorf, who's a town citizen representative, co-chair with Mary Lou Osborne, town citizen co-chair, Vincent Crossman, town citizen rep, Robert Demento, town citizen rep, Paul Giella, town citizen rep, Dave Girard, town citizen rep, Richard Lott, town citizen rep, Debbie McDonald, town citizen rep, Barbara Flavin and Karen Chavez, both Citizens Finance Committee reps, Monica Ford, the town treasurer, Matthew Crombie, the high school principal, Gary Scommel from the school committee, Frank Woods, the curriculum director for the Winthrop Public Schools, Richard Sofiuni, the facilities director. Could I have a motion to affirm?
Motion.
Motion by Councilor Devento, seconded by Councilor Sanford. Yes, Mary.
Did you mention John Massaro?
No, I didn't. Thank you. And we're going to add John Massaro as well, who's the superintendent of schools. Thank you. I'm glad you're here, Mary Lou. Thank you. So the motion to, yes, Bob's on here, to reappoint all those people, including John Massaro, has been made. Seconded. All those in favor to affirm, say aye.
On the motion, just a question. On the motion, just a clarification, please, Mr.
Yes.
President. Did you say it's for a 1-year appointment?
Yes, 1 year. That's what it's been traditionally.
Okay, because it says here without expiration. That's
right. Initially, I was doing it without expiration, but then I amended the motion to continue on the way it's been done traditionally.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Yes. Yep. Any other? This came up in the packet. John Massaro's name was like. Okay, all those in favor to affirm the appointment say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous.
Abstain. Oh.
Councilor Lettieri is abstaining because he is on the committee. Thank you. We have a thank you to the estate of Thomas L. O'Brien. The estate of Thomas L. O'Brien donated the sum of $100,000 for the purchase of new fiction and non-fiction hardcover books, and I'd like to acknowledge that donation and thank the estate of Thomas O'Brien for the $100,000 donation to the Winter Public Library. Thank you. And thank you again, Ms. Osborne, for being here as a library representative.
All those books have to be physical books.
I don't know. Can you clarify if they have to be physical books or if they can be? I believe that's the way it reads.
It
does say hardcover books.
It reads that it's for the purchase of new books.
So new books would be increasing the e-library catalogs. And
could possibly include that, sure.
Okay, thank you.
But it's to supplement the purchase of the books that we have in the regular budget.
So. Right. Okay, any other questions on that donation? Yes, Greg.
Is there like, because you have a budget, books are in that budget, does that get added to that budget as a supplemental area, or do you have X amount of years? What's the deal?
It's a one-time deal.
I know the gift is one-time, but I didn't know how the disbursement of that. Do you have to buy $100,000 worth of books right now, or are you planning
no,
on
no,
5 years, 10 years, 4 years?
It can be gradual. I don't know the plan of the library director and the trustees in guidance on that, but it certainly, I would would assume that it wouldn't be spent all in 1 year, maybe over the course of 10 years.
Could it also be invested in the dividend by the books? Is it restricted in any way that it couldn't be made as an annuity? So it could.
I don't know enough mm-hmm. about the request, but I can research that for you.
All right. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
End of year transfers, Tim, they're on, correct? No. Okay, the next three motions talk about the, I'll read them. Motion two, the town council authorized the redevelopment of Miller Field subject to funding and review of plans for said redevelopment or take any other action relative thereto. Given that we have postponed the funding motion and that we do have a major, we have a presentation next week on Miller Field and on the drainage, I would accept a motion to postpone this motion also to July 14th.
Motion to postpone.
Motion to postpone by Councilor Lettieri, seconded by Councilor Boyajian. All those in favor to postpone, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Motion that the town council vote to permanently close Cross Street from the southeasterly boundary of Miller Field to the northwesterly boundary of the Winthrop Little League Field as part of the Miller Field redevelopment. Or take any other action relative thereto. That also makes sense to postpone.
Motion to postpone.
Motion to postpone by Councilor Lettieri, seconded by Councilor Boyajian. All those in favor of postponing the motion say aye.
Are we going to notify the neighbors
yeah,
of that
precinct
street?
Is that?
That's my,
yeah, my precinct.
Yeah, before
I have
any
a
of that
meeting, before we do that.
Before any of that's done, that motion, I believe, my intent would be that that motion would then be referred to public safety and TSEC.
And then back to us.
Council President, could we also look into possibly a traffic study as to the impact on that?
Yeah, that would all be part of TSAC and public safety. I would assume they would do that.
We'd have to commission it. The money would have to come from authorized from the area.
But it's, right now, it's. I just want it on the agenda so that it's something that we could consider as part of that overall project. With no specific. I put specific boundaries on it, but those boundaries may well change, and the motion may not pass. But definitely a piece of the consideration should be referred to public safety and to TSAC and let them make the determination what kinds of studies they want to do to come back to.
Motion to postpone.
The motion has been made. Yep, go ahead.
Maybe Mary Lou would know, but didn't they do some traffic studies for that area in regard to Cross Street already?
Not
on the new school, on the SBA initial endeavor? There was a traffic study, I thought.
Understanding is there was a traffic study done, but the traffic study didn't contemplate a closing of Cross Street.
So it would need to be
a whole new study.
I can live with it. I just thought that.
Okay, motion to postpone to the next meeting. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. And the third motion that the council authorize the proposed drainage improvements at Lewis Lake subject to funding and review of the plans for said redevelopment and take any action relative thereto. I also
motion to postpone.
Motion second. By Councilor Lettieri to postpone. Second by Councilor Sanford. All those in favor postpone say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. The next item, the Winthrop Airport hazards, we took out of order and already voted it. Contract
aye.
Four.
Aye.
Okay, the fire truck we have, excuse me, thank you, Councilor. A motion that the town council declare the fire department's 1999 Pierce Sabre Pumper, VN number 4P1CTO2U6XA001329 surplus and dispose of it to the highest bidder or take any other action relative thereto. But I have a motion to dispose of the fire.
Motion
by Councilor Boyajian. Okay, second. Was it Lettieri that made the motion?
Yes.
Okay. Councilor Lettieri made the motion, seconded by Councilor Boyajian. Any discussion on the motion?
Sure.
Yeah.
Could the chief talk about it?
Sure. Chief, would you give us
the. We have a 1990 Pierce fire truck, which we're replacing, a replacement for a left Wisconsin Sunday night. It will be in Wakefield Thursday morning, which equipment will be mounted on and will take the place. This truck has been out of service because it needed approximately a $6,000 repair a couple of months ago. To avoid putting that kind of money in a truck that we planned on getting rid of at the end of June, 1st of July, I borrowed a reserve piece from Revere, which you've seen running around town. So again, we're pushing forward. It has to be deemed surplus. It's not worthy of firefighting duty anywhere else. So most likely, other than some collector who might want it for parts, the value of it is probably in scrap metal. So the average piece of surplus fire apparatus runs, depending on what the metal market is doing, close to $3,000. It costs some money to drain the oil and the fluids out of it, and it has to be towed into the junkyard and kind of drive it. So that's pretty much it. It's going to bring somewhere in the vicinity of between $2,000 and $3,000, depending on the price.
Chief, just one clarification. The motion reads 1999. You said 1990, which is it?
Oh, it was 99.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to make sure the motion was correct. Any questions from the council?
That's a good one. It's goodbye.
Okay. Be the highest bidder. It's going up for bid.
He's going to use it for parades. You win.
I don't know. Motion. Has been made and seconded. Any further discussion on the motion? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Get the bid list out there, Chief.
The bidding begins.
Okay, contract four, a motion that the town manager is authorized to access $537,681.09 in available funds from the Mass Water Resources Authority's infiltration/inflow local finance assistance program, of which $314,760.82 is in the form of a grant, and $222,920.27 is obligated debt. The $222,920.27 is appropriate for the purpose of financing this debt for the replacement of aged water sewer main, for the aged sewer main, to eliminate infiltration and inflow of groundwater into the town sewer system in the Cottage Hill surrounding area and Pico Beach surrounding area, including all costs incidental or related thereto. And to meet this appropriation, the treasurer, with the approval of the town manager, is authorized to borrow $222,920.27 and issue bonds or notes of the town under Chapter 44 of the General Laws or any other enabling authority. That the treasurer, with the approval of the town manager, is authorized to borrow all or a portion of such money from MWRA, known as the authority, and in connection therewith to enter into a loan agreement, a financial assistance agreement with the authority, and otherwise to contract with the authority with respect to such loan for any grants or aid available for the project and for the financing thereof, which grants and or aid shall be expended for the project in addition to the amount appropriated and to be awarded under this order, and that the town manager is authorized to acquire by purchase, eminent domain, or otherwise such rights, titles, easements as they may be necessary for such purpose, to abandon such rights, titles, and easements as they are no longer required, to expend all funds available for the project, and to take any other action necessary or convenient to carry out the project. Motion.
Motion.
Motion by Councilor.
Second.
Second by Councilor. I didn't know which one he did. Second by Councilor Varone. Discussion on the motion.
This motion to approve it, is it going to the finance
this
committee?
This motion now has to be referred to finance, so that's your motion. So motion by Councilor Guancori to refer to finance. Second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Delvento? Second by Councilor Delvento?
Yep.
Okay. Motion to by Councilor Guancori, second by Councilor Delvento to refer to finance. All those in favor of the motion to refer, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Do we need a public hearing on it?
Yep.
Next, okay, so we'll schedule a public hearing for the 21st. Steve?
I just want to just quickly.
Yes.
We did award contract four to Deep Police Corp. They will be mobilizing July 15th of this month to start work in the Pico Park area. Some of the sewer work, which was discovered during the engineering, is in that area. I don't know if there's any way to get it on. You have a special meeting? Or is that
2:14? Meeting on the 21st, which is a week from today, but that doesn't give us enough time to advertise, correct?
The 14th is a week from today.
I mean, the 14th is a week from today. But our regular next regular is the 21st, and I think given that we have to have a public hearing, we need to do it on the 21st, correct, Tim? Yeah, so that we get the 7 days. Yeah. So we'll postpone this. We have referred it to finance, and we'll bring it up again on the meeting on the 21st. We'll have a public hearing that same night. Okay. So all those in favor of postponement, never mind, we already referred it to finance.
Mr. President?
Yes.
If it's okay with the finance committee, do we want to have a meeting on next Tuesday night prior to our council meeting?
That's fine with me. Okay with the finance committee?
Yep. Can you post that to me, 6:30 in the council chambers?
6:30 next Tuesday, the 14th.
Can we change it yet?
Thank you.
Okay. The special council next week, we're scheduled to have a meeting with the Millerfield Lewis Lake Drainage Project reconstruction efforts that we talked about earlier. And on that, at that meeting, after the presentation by the town manager, we will take the votes of the motions that we just talked about. Also that night, we have the Winter Beach Restoration update coming from the DCR. I hope. I'm waiting for confirmation on that, so I'm going to do both of those that same night.
On the 14th.
Right. Special meeting on the 14th for those three items. Also on that meeting, we will put on the agenda end of year transfers in case any come up between now and then. Tim doesn't anticipate that there will be any, but we'll put it on the agenda just to cover that space. Public comment? Chief?
Yeah, just on the Millers Field Cross Street project. Obviously, other meetings, it's been brought up that I've been against this closing of Cross Street. I'm not against anything, however, I have to take into consideration the entire town when we look at something like this. And I would ask if we are going to do a traffic study, that we at least wait for the Fort Bank School to reopen while we do this traffic study, because it's an unfair study otherwise. We don't know the impact of that. We're adding two schools down there, not one, which is a huge difference. So I felt obligated to at least caution everyone that we need to move slow and really have this examined and studied by traffic consultants and taken the entire community in the past through and why we use that as a secondary street versus a primary street on certain emergencies. So thank you, and I know you all consider that as well as I will.
Great. Thank you, Chief. Appreciate it. Any further public comment? Yes.
Hey, Bill, Nick Bracey, with that 30 Franklin Street. Thank you, Council, for bringing up the neighbors of Cross Street. It's right here that I can talk about. Since Main Street's been closed in front of the high school, we've seen increased traffic coming down Franklin Street. I have two young children, and people don't exactly abide by the speeding limit laws.
A little louder, please, sir.
People don't abide by the speeding limit laws, and it's very scary, just not just for my kids, but obviously there's a lot of kids playing Little League T-ball and whatnot down the on the field. So I just heard about the closing of Cross Street, and I want to come down and just make sure that you guys are looking into the neighbors, the residents, before I even heard about this, I was thinking, who do I talk to about possibly speed bumps? I don't know if that's something you've considered at all, but there's a lot of speeding down that street, and it's worrisome to myself being a father, and I'm sure some other residents have lived on Franklin Street. So I appreciate your due diligence in looking into that before consider everything else. Thank you, sir.
Any further public comment? Seeing none, public relations. Neighborhood meeting. Precinct 1 and 2 is Thursday night at 7 at the E.B. Newton, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
So is that a public meeting? What is the status of that? How is it?
Neighborhood meeting?
Yeah.
It's a public meeting. I think it would be more, it's for the whole town. It's a public meeting for the whole town. We're holding it for the precincts so we can get more feedback from the abutters and the surrounding area. But it's open for anybody.
The question I ask is, I heard we were having one on Pleasant Street too, and I didn't know if we had one on Pleasant Street.
We did, we had one.
Was that a public meeting?
Yeah.
Was it posted?
Yeah.
It was posted on the town calendar for Pleasant Street?
Right. I believe it. I wouldn't bet my soul on it, but I believe it was. Yeah, those are public meetings. We did have one for the Pleasant Street. We, in the past, had MWRA public meetings.
I understand that. The Pleasant Street was never posted. There was never a date or time. So I never saw it. I don't miss a lot of meetings, but it was never posted. So that was, in a sense, not an open meeting. And we have to be careful about that type of stuff.
Okay, thank you. This one is posted, and it is at 7 p.m., and it is a public meeting on Thursday. Our special council meeting I already talked about. And next, the next regular meeting on the 21st is the continuation of the public hearing for the SDOD on Walnut Street. So that will be after the public meeting, after the neighborhood meeting, and I assume that public hearing will be finished and closed that night. I wanted to thank the chief, fire chief, for the efforts with the fireworks. They were tremendous.
I would be remiss if my new administrative assistant, Kelly Parker, who did a lot of the work, she was out selling t-shirts in front of some of the stores around town. There was a big demand to bring t-shirts back. We went out with 400 this year. They sold in a hurry. We sold the last few of them down at the Horribles Parade. But again, I had a lot of help with Kelly Parker. And thank you for everybody who did donate.
Thank you. And also the way the fireworks display took off, that some of the people were a little bit disappointed that the fireworks weren't as good as they used to be, and then we found out that the fireworks that weren't as good as they used to be weren't the town fireworks. So we had a great display of great fireworks followed by greater fireworks, and so it was a great night. And to the Point people, Peter Gobiel and the Gobiel family in charge of the Horribles Parade. Somebody told me the parade was horrible. I was there, I thought it was horrible, and that's what it's supposed to be. And Mike, your group running past years' horrible parades, it was really interesting to see people that you saw in 1988, and they looked different in 2015. But that whole weekend was just a great presentation. And I also wanted to talk about the parks. They've been having open houses. They're not calling them open houses. I forget what they're calling them. But each Tuesday night for the last several weeks and next Tuesday night, they've had these affairs where people arrive. And I was at Daw last week and then Pico again tonight. And the crowd is tremendous. Patsy Cimino is down there cooking. And great input from the people. Next week is the last one of those, and it's a makeup for Coughlin Park. So if you can make it to Coughlin Park. Comment was made that they thought they were going to get people from the neighborhood, and what happened was after the first one, it was so good that the people from the neighborhood from the first one went to the second, and now the people from the first and second went to the third, and it's really growing. It's a great thing, showing off the park.
I gotta tell you, I was down Coughlin Park like all weekend during the 4th of July. I could not believe how many people were down there. Kids, the families, so many children are enjoying their park, Stephen. They just absolutely love it. And it was the first time my husband actually walked on it and felt how soft it was and, you know, how important it is if one of the children fall. You know what I mean? Like they've got that buffer there. And it was a great job. Kids love it. And all different ages. I mean, there were kids that were on the, you know, playing in the playground, but then they were off to the side. The bigger kids were playing something else. And then, you know, everywhere you looked, there was a bunch of kids. It was really nice to see that.
So it was a great combined effort of the Parks Committee, the DPW under Steve's direction, and these parks open houses are being run by Parks and Rec under Sean Driscoll's direction. So it's a real pulling together. And I know Pico Park being in, I see it all the time, the traffic going to Pico Park, kids walking, bouncing basketballs, it's really, really nice.
It's nice.
So thank you all. If there is no further public relations, I'll accept the motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Council Brown, second. Biagio, no discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Thank you.